2016 National Sales Meeting. Please, everyone, let's give a special thank you to Amira Willenhagen. Thank you, Amira. Into one. Music truly is the universal language and has the ability to unite us as one. San Antonio's finest musicians took us on a musical journey that speaks to our emotions. Each of you is like a member of this orchestra, a group of highly trained players working together as a coordinated team, like the violin. Thank you. Like the trumpet. Like the flute. Beautiful. If all of these musicians, or all of you, decided to go your own direction and play whatever you want, what might that sound like? But by leading as one, with unity, purpose, and direction, the result is quite different. Beautiful. The effective melody of communication allows us to share our vision and strategies for sustainable growth. It's the dynamic rhythm of quality that keeps us focused, and it keeps us focused on consistent improvements. It's the powerful harmony of partnership to connecting us all to performance excellence. You may not know this, but every piece of music has one thing in common. I've learned a lot with the power of this baton, by the way. Seven basic notes, A, B, C, D, E, F, G. So innovative. How those seven notes are assembled and arranged makes all the difference between forgettable and legendary. How we compose the notes and put them in the right sequence can transport us from average to outstanding. At SMOR, it's our time right now to make beautiful music together and lead as one. Are you ready? Yeah. Please help me thank this beautiful orchestra. Thank you very much. The role of the band also been the man truly responsible for the beautiful music you just heard. Our conductor, Dr. John Salantia. John, thank you so much. Standing in front of you, and I get to do it again this year. It's an amazing feeling. Standing in front of that orchestra is absolutely incredible as well. Welcome to you. On behalf of the executive committee and the leadership team, I once again have the honor and pleasure of welcoming you to your national sales meeting. I do want to start off by also wishing all of you and your families a very happy 2016, a happy, healthy, and prosperous new year to all of you. I hope you enjoyed your maybe short break with your families. It's always a nice time to be with the families at the holiday. It would be inappropriate to go any further today without acknowledging the horrific events that took place in Paris back in November. I know that your thoughts and prayers and your hearts are with all of our friends, We've all been affected in some way, shape, or form by those activities. And I know that you think about all of our colleagues and our friends in Paris. Our thoughts and prayers are certainly with them. I want to also offer a few welcomes, if I may, to some of those not able to be with us and some special guests that we have with us today. The folks back in Creekview, we want to say welcome to you. We know you're watching. We're sorry you can't be here with us today, but we appreciate all of the efforts that you make in support of our business. So thank you very much to our friends. We have decided to change the attire back in Dallas, and we will be going with tails. Also, I'd like to welcome some special guests we have with us, visiting us from our comics group, Lucia Dumas, Alexander Lindshoff, and Thierry Robin. If you're here, please stand. Thank you for being with us. Welcome. I'd also like to introduce a few special guests that we have. An old friend of ours from Dallas is now the President of Canada, Pierre Bertrand. Pierre, are you here? Welcome to Pierre. Where's Pierre? There it is. Welcome, Pierre. Country General Manager of Mexico. Kurt, are you here? There's Kurt. Welcome. Personally, I want to offer a special welcome to a group of colleagues who have been amazingly supportive of our business. This is the first year they've been able to attend our meeting, and I just want them to know how much we appreciate their efforts. We have the Essler Advisory Panel, our doctors. These are the doctors that are probably the busiest doctors we have in the country, always willing to give us their time, their input, and their efforts, and they have a lot to do with the success that we've had. I hope they can stand and be recognized. Thank you to our advisory panel. Welcome. Family. I know they're here. I'm not sure exactly where they are. The Vision Source leadership, I know you guys are here. Our friends at Vision Source, where are you guys? Thank you so much for being with us. And the other new member of the family, the PERC leadership, where's our friends from PERC? There they are. Welcome to our PERC friends. Special to me, not that they all aren't special to me, but this group particularly. In 2015, let's say we had a lot going on at Essilor, and our relationship that we have with the press is one that's very special to us. And I know that starting their year, just like we are, for them to take out of their time to be with us is something that's very special. Please, the members of the press who are joining us today, thank you so much. Please stand. We appreciate everything you do to support our business. National Sales Meeting. How about first time attendees stand up? We'd love to welcome you and give you a special welcome. Thank you for being here. Good to see those good faces. We also want to say just quickly a welcome to the groups that make up the rest of the Essilor family. I'd be remiss if I didn't mention some of those, and I hope we didn't miss anybody, but let's say thank you to all of the rest of the family who's joined us. Thank you for being here today. So, it's about leadership and how you lead. It's not easy being a leader, you know, it really isn't. I think it takes a special character, a special personality to be the leader. So how do you lead? Well, there's a few ways I'd like to share with you, at least in my opinion, we lead as Essilor. I thought this quote was a good way to kick things off. Truly productivity is not an accident. It's the result of hard work that each and every one of you have put in. It's always the result of a commitment to excellence, intelligent planning, and focused effort. And that's why we joined together at the beginning of the year to kick off our year the right way and make sure we get a good, strong start. And I'll tell you, a lot of people put in a lot of time and effort to make sure these next few days are extremely productive for you. And let me also just say thank you. I never get tired of congratulating you for a very good year. Fortunately, in February, this will be my 8th year, so 7 times I've had the pleasure of standing up in front of you and saying thank you. Thank you for the tireless efforts each and every one of you make. Another outstanding year at Essilor. Thank you very much to each of you. So let's talk a little bit about leadership. How do you lead? Well, I thought again a quote that to me rang, and some of you know Simon Sinek. I think he's a guy who really has a way of taking some complex thoughts and boiling them down to some simple things. And I really like this one because I think stress is something we talk a lot about. It's part of our life. It's something that we can't avoid. But working hard for something we don't care about, I think that's something you can truly define as stress. Working hard for something we love is called passion. This year I spent a lot of time out in the field with many of you, and the passion that you've shown for this business is why we've continued to be successful. And again, I'll just say on behalf of the executive committee, we thank you for all those efforts that you've put in. So how do we define leadership? Well, to me, it starts with your DNA. It starts with what you're made of. And to me, that DNA are our brands, the brands that represent us. Any leader has that core that they're made of, that brands that they're known about. For us, Transitions, Verilux, Crizal, Experia UV, and the newest member of the family that you'll be hearing a lot about over the next few days, Izen. So, as we continue down the path of discussion of how do you lead, what better way to lead than to give back? I'm so proud every time I participate in any of the activities, and I'm sure you are as well, with the S4 Vision Foundation. It's about improving lives by improving sight. And two organizations that really epitomize that are the S4 Vision Foundation and the Vision Impact Institute. I know many of you participate in the activities of the foundation. Thank you for your efforts on behalf of the foundation. And I think we should really give Steve Schaller a round of applause for the great job he's done in bringing the foundation to where it is today. Thank you, Steve. All right, Steve. There it is. I know that all of you will support Kim Shuey as she takes over and looks to take the S4 Vision Foundation into the future. Where are you, Kim? Where's Kim? Thank you, Kim. There she is. You have all of our support. I know you do. Congratulations. I don't know if you know as much about the Vision Impact Institute as you do about the foundation. You should be very proud of the activities the Vision Impact Institute does. Maureen Cavanaugh leads that group. Where are you, Maureen? Thank you so much for the efforts that you've made, along with Kristen Gross. Why don't you guys stand for a minute? Where are you? Sorry for the barrier. I'll tell you, I have a first-hand experience that I will share with you, but the Vision Impact Institute's efforts are truly revolutionary in what they're doing and trying to help people understand the value of vision that goes beyond just seeing. It's about changing economies. It's about changing countries, making them more sustainable. I mean, what an amazing thing. You should feel very proud that you've supported the efforts that these organizations make. I thought I'd tell you a personal story, if I may, about how it's affected me. It really had a life-changing experience this year. One of the other organizations, in addition to the S4 Vision Foundation that you support, is Optometry Giving Sight. Optometry Giving Sight does some other things in addition to the World Sight Day Challenge, which I think most of you are familiar with. Optometry Giving Sight's efforts are really to teach them to fish, if you will, to get on the ground, to build optometry programs, something sustainable for communities. I know our friends at Vision Source support that group in a big way, as do all of us. I want to just take you on a quick journey that I took about a month and a half ago to a little country called Malawi in southeastern Africa. This is a country that, for the majority of the population, no electricity. For the majority of the population, no running water. But yet they're a humble group of people, a proud group of people. And the reason I speak, for many reasons, but one of the key reasons I speak to you today on their behalf is because they insisted I do so. I spent a week in Malawi, and to a person that I met, they encouraged me to come back to the group at S4 and make sure you knew how much they appreciated what you do to support them. So let me give you a little idea of the experience. So you land in Malawi from the air. It doesn't maybe look a lot different than a more rural area you might see anywhere around the world. In the middle of the picture here is, in the center, is our host, part of the Optometry Giving Sight, Hilda, and the executive director of Optometry Giving Sight, Clive Miller. These people are amazing people who have a will to support in a way that is overwhelming to some extent. Our trip began up in the north in Mazuzu. This would be a typical village in Malawi. The women travel upwards of 2 to 3 miles, walk up to 2 to 3 miles to get water and carry it back. I have this vision in my mind of telling my 17-year-old daughter, sweetie, I want you to walk 3 miles, get some water, put a bucket on your head, and bring it back to the house. You can only imagine. This is something that's part of the routine of life for these people. Amazing. The homes, as you see here, pretty typical of what we saw during our stay. This is, again, Mzuzu up in the north. We visited the college that you've had a lot to do with supporting and building. Graduated their third class of optometry students, about 20 to 25 students. I was taken by the mission statement of Mzuzu University. They travel halfway around the world. The mission statement is similar to what you'd see in any university, very aspirational, the things that they want to achieve. People are people, and they believe they can achieve these things. I was really proud to represent you there and to take all of the accolades and hopefully bring them back to you, what these people felt for what you've done to support them. This is the optometry school class. On the far left is the head of school. She's a graduate of the University of Alabama at Birmingham College of Optometry. What an amazing woman, dedicated her life to training the students, which, by the way, the broadest scope of practice in the entire world. These students are doing everything from seeing basic eye exams to treating eye diseases to doing minor surgical procedures. That's her task. In 5 years, she takes a high school student and turns them into an optometrist who's providing the broadest scope of care in the world. What an amazing job she does, and the resources she has are minimal, as you can only imagine. This is a typical clinic. In the middle there, the gentleman who's got his arms crossed is a graduate of the first optometry class. He ran this clinic. As you can see behind him, the acuity charts, not quite what you're used to seeing. One thing was interesting, and he wouldn't let us show it because he has his arms crossed and a white lab coat on. If you open up that lab coat, he actually has a shirt with an eye chart on it, something that was given to him, and he literally uses that to assess visual performance at times. Certainly making the best use of all the resources he has. The two gentlemen on the far right of the image are graduates of the opticianry program, which is down in Lilongwe in the capital. By the way, the optometrists, when they are accepted to the College of Optometry, get a white lab coat. They are so proud to wear that white lab coat. It means the world to them. They're so proud to be accepted into this program. And by the way, they would not be able to do it without the support you and Escalor provide. I thought I'd also show you what a typical dispensary looks like in Mzuzu. A little hard to see, but up against that blackboard, what they've done is they've taken a cardboard box, poked holes in it, and put frames in there. And it functions extremely well for them to be able to do the job they need to do. Amazing how they use the resources that they have. This year is the class of the opticianry program. We've now moved down to the south, to the capital of Lilongwe. A little more progressive in terms of at least the lifestyle, but still majority without power, without water. One thing I noticed about this picture when I saw it afterwards, no matter where you go in the world, putting bunny ears behind someone's head is a universal message. I really truly wish each and every one of you could have experienced this with me. It was amazing. And I want to bring you just one very quick story. This is a young man with congenital cataracts, born with cataracts. Happens in the US, happens in other parts of the world. As my colleagues in the room know, if you were born with cataracts, congenital cataracts, those would be removed pretty much at birth. This young man, 5 years old, had just had his cataracts removed. Let me give you a little image of what that's like. That's like basically strapping a child's arms to their body for the first 5 years of their life, unstrapping them at 5 and asking them to try to function. That's about what it's like to have no clear image coming to the back of the eye. I wish you could have experienced this. That's his grandfather. They allowed me to take these pictures because they wanted you to see the things that you're doing, the things that leaders do to make a difference for people. This is the first time he put on a pair of glasses that you provided. What you can't see, and I wish I had video to show you, he stood up. He wanted to touch us. He wanted to look at us. He was seeing something he had never seen before. That feeling is amazing. And I wanted to make sure I brought that back to you so you could have that feeling of knowing that we don't just make lenses. We don't just do lab services. What we do is make a difference in people's lives. My colleagues see it every day. Each of you don't. This is an extreme, but these are the things we're doing every day in every part of the world, and you should be very proud of of the company you work for and the things that they do, along with our great partners. So congratulations. It's like an emotional roller coaster for me. I get to conduct the band, the orchestra, and I'll tell you a story about Africa. What an amazing experience I hope each of you have. I thought I'd tell you a story that I've been sharing with colleagues over the past probably 8 or 9 months. So I think it's relevant not only to the optometric profession, the eye care profession, but I think it's relevant to each and every one of you as a metaphor and something I want you to think about for our profession. Have a chance to listen to a futurist. I don't know how many of you have had a chance to hear futurists. They're interesting people. They're essentially futurists, although this may sound odd, are historians. They really have a keen understanding of history. Because in order to predict the business future, they need to understand that. And it was interesting, this one stuck with me. This gentleman futurist posed a question to the audience. This was an audience of eye care providers. And the question was, are more people maimed or killed, injured or killed, crossing the crosswalk or jaywalking? And the audience, probably like you, thought about that for a moment, pondered, and said, well, if he's asking the question, it's probably not the simple answer. And to cut to the chase, his message was that, in fact, more people are killed or injured crossing in a crosswalk than jaywalking. So how is that relevant to us? And he went on to explain, when we cross in a crosswalk, we feel safe. We're not really taking a risk in our own mind. People are going to stop. Things are going to happen. We have expectations of what will happen. When we jaywalk, we're very cautious. We're making sure we're aware. We're taking calculated risks. And his message was, as a profession, and I would suggest to us in the room, as an industry, we need to jaywalk more. We're very conservative, typically. And so I challenge each and every one of you that if we continue to cross in a crosswalk and take the less challenged path, that in fact, we're more likely to end up on the wrong side. But if we jaywalk, we cautiously take those risks, then in fact, as leaders, that will get us to where we need to be. And I would suggest that many of you have done that. But as you traverse your way through the next 3 or 4 days, think a bit about that. Are we crossing at the crosswalk? Are we taking that easy route? That's not the way we do it at S4. Are we jaywalking? Are we cautiously making sure we observe, but that we take those calculated risks? That's what we do. It's not easy, but that's what we do. Innovation is revolutionizing things. It's changing things. And I leave you with a couple of messages. One, a revolution doesn't happen when society adopts new tools. It's not just about new tools. It happens when society adopts new behaviors. And you, each and every one of you, is going to lead the way to assure we can adopt those new behaviors. Finally, I ask each of you to dream more than others think practical. Expect more than others think possible. Care more than others think wise. What do you think? Are we ready? Thank you. We're very excited about your achievements in 2015. Congratulations. I hope during your stay here in San Antonio, we can celebrate your achievements.
Ha ha ha! President, Essilor of America, Eric Leonard.
Colleagues, friends, partners, feel really very welcome at this National Science Meeting. It's so good to start the year with you all together, with all this energy. I'm first going to read a short message from the former president of Essilor of America and current chief operating officer of the group, John Carrier. John is not here today, but he wanted me to read a short message to your intent. My first NSM was 20 years ago, in 97, in Tucson, Arizona. I have attended each and every NSM in the last 20 years. I will miss it this year, and I will miss all of you. What you have achieved in the last 20 years is just amazing. And 2015 has been no exception. Congratulations. I have a great confidence that you will continue on the same path of success in 2016. And it is true, 2015 has been once again a very, very solid year. And the first thing I want to tell you is just thank you. Thank you for all the good job in 2015, for all what you have done that have made this 2015 years, that was my first year as president of Essilor of America, such a good year. So thank you very much. But it's clear as also that as we get bigger, our responsibility in our industry get bigger. And that's the reason why I would like to focus my short speech this morning on our mission. Our mission is to improve life by improving sight. And in 16, we are committed to our mission as never before. But what does that mean? What does that mean, this mission? What concretely do we have to do? Of course, the first thing is that we are going to spend more money, more resources on our non-for-profit activities. In 15, for the first time in our history, we gave over 100,000 spectacles to children in need in the US. That's a big achievement, 100,000 spectacles. But we know that there are 12 million children in the US that need a pair of spectacles. It's key for them. It's key for them to succeed in their life. So we give 100,000, the need is 12 million. So there's a huge effort for all of us to make it much, much bigger. Other key activity in our non-for-profit is our Vision Impact Institute. We are in a very important field, the field of vision. But in fact, very few people know the importance and why it's so important to have a good vision, what is the impact on the life of people. So we need to grow the knowledge and we need to share the knowledge. And that's the role of the Vision Impact Institute. And we need to use more of this. But of course, our mission is not limited to our non-for-profit activities. It's not just a small group in our company that we will work on it. It's much broader than that. It's really at the core of what we are. First of all, our mission is also about finding new products. We are investing 150 million in research and development every year. It's more than anyone in the industry, so we have a big responsibility. And innovation in terms of product is absolutely key because our needs are changing. A century ago, most people were farmers. They were seeing at distance. 20 years ago, we were mainly watching TV, reading books, and so we were reading at maybe, I don't know, 15, 18 inches. Now, we are surrounded by screen, by smartphones that we are looking for very close. And it's created a lot of strain on our visual system. So we need new product. And that's the reason why you are going to hear a lot in these coming days about Eisen, because we really believe that we need to create this transformation from the basic classical single vision lens to this new generation of advanced single vision lens. The third key point in delivering our mission is about protecting the eyes. And protecting the eyes is a real, real serious issue. Our life expectancy is increasing. We are living now 85 years in average. It will probably go up to 100, 110 years in the coming 25 years. So it's absolutely key to protect the eyes. And we know that we have more, and we are, our eyes are more and more under a lot of light. Natural light, the light of the screens, the light of that I have in front of me, it's a lot of light. And this light is more and more powerful. It's more and more blue white light. It's a light with a high energy, and that has a big impact on our eyes. So we absolutely need to protect the eyes of the people. It's very, very important. And you know, when we are looking at protecting against UV, protecting against sun, protecting against the blue light, it's not a niche, it's for everyone. And it's our role, it's our mission to be sure that it happens, because it's not the case today. In order to make this mission happen, the most critical element is you. You are the ones in sales, in marketing, in